Hey guys, good evening. Natto Soup here, and today I'm doing my June ArtSnacks challenge with primarily the materials included in my June box, which are a Spectra AD alcohol marker, a Kuratake number 7 brush pen. This is a water-based brush pen, a General's layout pencil in extra black, a Fibralo brush by Karen Dosh, and something I will not be using in this is the mini sketchbook, mini notebook, because it's just a little bit smaller than I prefer to work. So I have a thumbnail sketch drawn, given the materials included, and the fact that like I've been watching so many people do mermaid drawings, I thought I would do that. So I'm going to start tonight out with a sketch with my General's layout pencil. It is a darker pencil, so it may be harder for me to erase. It may leave some ghosting, but I am trying to stick to what's in my box. And I'm sorry if I sound a little bit hoarse. I am recovering from a cold. And I'm doing this sketch on fluid watercolor paper. So those of you who watch this channel, you guys know I don't really use wooden pencils a whole lot. I don't really care for them. When I do have these challenge videos, I do try to use them when they come up, and I do use color pencils. So I sort of handled the layout pencil like I would a color pencil. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to ink this with waterproof ink. This is Mitsuo Ida ink. I do plan on using the Kuratake number 7 later on, but I have a specific plan for this because it's water-based, and I plan on doing a lot of water media. Now, the Spectra AD is an alcohol marker, which means I'm going to have to clean off or erase all of this pencil marks, or it's going to ruin the nib on this marker. So for those of you who enjoy using your alcohol markers and you keep wrecking the nib and you're using them with graphite, that could be why. You may not be getting a clean enough erase. So I'm going to go ahead and start inking with this Mitsuo Ida, which is waterproof and alcohol marker proof. We'll be right back. Okay, so before I can go any further with this piece, I need to let the ink cure. And you can allow your ink to cure from anywhere from an hour to 24 hours. I found that with alcohol markers, my best result is to allow my ink to cure for 24 hours. So I will check back in with you guys sometime tomorrow. Hey guys, good evening. So we're going to be working on this Art Snacks challenge tonight. Yesterday, I inked this piece, and now I'm going to go ahead and erase it. I originally penciled it with this General's Layout pencil, which is a darker pencil, so I may have some difficulty erasing everything cleanly. That's just part of the challenge. And yeah, it does indeed look like, let me see if pulling in will help you guys. It does indeed look like I'm having difficulty. See, I erased her whole face and it left ghosting. So if you are going to be inking over something, a layout pencil is not a very good choice for your needs because it's going to leave marks on the paper. Alright guys, so my layout pencil is erased to the best of my ability. There is a lot of ghosting. It was very difficult to erase all that layout pencil. So if you are an inker who enjoys inking over your pencil and you need your pencil cleanly erased because say you're using Copics, I do not recommend the layout pencil. So because this particular ArtSnacks challenge box really didn't inspire me a whole lot, I brought in some additional materials. I do want to showcase what was in my box, but I pulled out a lot of my Copic markers and I'm going to be using my masking Frisket. And I have a tutorial on how to use masking Frisket with alcohol markers in case, since so many of you guys have asked about that. So please do check that out here. But I'm going to use the masking Frisket to mask off the mermaid and the fish and just like a whole bunch of things so I can go over with this custom Copic Wide in Ranger's Pool. And I have a tutorial for that as well. And basically create an alcohol marker wash to tone the background. And then I'm going to go over that with these two spray bottles. This is Pinata's Baja Blue ink in a spray bottle. It's an alcohol ink. And this is Copic's BG000, another alcohol ink. So I'm going to go ahead and get started masking this off. And I think I'm going to have to work. You know what? I'm going to grab a full sheet and we'll see where we go from there. And what I like to do when I'm masking things off with masking Frisket is I like to tape it down so it doesn't shift a whole lot. And I like to use washi tape to do that. Make sure it is shiny side up because this is that the shiny is like the plastic that holds your masking Frisket onto the paper. I'm going to capture as much of what I want to mask in one go because the more cuts you have, the more likely it is that your marker is going to seep underneath it and affect it. So you're going to want, if you have it, a fine tip Sharpie like this. And you're also going to want some rubbing alcohol and a paper towel before you get too started with this, as well as an X-Acto knife or a pair of scissors. Thank you. Okay, so my mask has been traced. I'm going to go ahead and remove my washi tape, and I'm going to set this aside because I decided I want to do an all-over wash to tone the piece, and I'm going to use B quadruple zero, so that's B with four zeros, which is a very, very light blue in a Copic Wide, and this is from Copic. Since I do want to push that sort of underwater look. And I'm going to set this to the side to give myself room to work on cutting out this mask. And you're going to want an X-Acto blade of some sort for the really tight curves. This is a swivel X-Acto blade made by X-Acto, but I like to use a scissor or a pair of scissors for the larger part. So something I found really handy to keep around the studio are alcohol prep pads. And you can get these fairly cheaply on Amazon. You can check my description for a link if you're interested. And these don't make quite as much mess as spray alcohol and a a paper towel. And the reason you want to use this is because Sharpies are alcohol solvent, and they will affect your alcohol marker that you put on top of it. Now, because they're alcohol solvent, you can use an alcohol prep pad to sort of just clean that Sharpie off before you apply your mask. These are also great for, if you can get the larger ones, they're great for cleaning up messes your spray alcohol inks might cause. And of course, they're just the sort of thing you might want to have in your first aid kit anyway. All right, so we've got our mask ready. It is now time to apply it. And I constantly talk about how I wish somebody would introduce colored Frisket so I could see what I was doing. And when I'm applying a complicated piece like this, I like to work in stages. So I will trim the paper backing off, apply my piece of Frisket, and move on. And you want to burnish it, and that means press down and rub on it to make sure it adheres properly. This is the sort of thing that sometimes you wish you had four hands. There we go. So you could really get it down properly. And see, if you don't burnish it, your ink is going to seep underneath and cause potential problems. And this is where I maybe goofed up in how I did this. So, because I don't, you know what, I'll sacrifice the fish. I have a feeling the fish is sacrificed anyway. And it's sort of what's keeping this piece attached. So let's see if I can. And people underestimate how much troubleshooting goes into being an artist. How much, like, figuring out where you went wrong, backtracking and correcting. You know, I think a lot of people assume we just sort of know what we're doing when we make these things. But there is always opportunity for growth and to learn. And I have a lot of growing I want to do as an artist. In fact, I think I tore that piece of the mask. Dang it. I have a lot of growing I want to do as an artist. So, you know, these sort of learning opportunities are still very valuable to me. All right, let's. Let's cut this here. Reapply. Hopefully the long piece will continue to go down where it's supposed to. We'll find out. You want to line it up with your line art. Okay, so we did a pretty good job of getting the mask down. And what I masked off was the mermaid, some of the fish, and the seaweed. So I'm just burnishing out any air bubbles, making sure there's a tight seal as much as I can. There are a few bubbles here and there, which I'm trying to correct, because if you have a bubble towards the edge, the ink will pool underneath it, and that's really a problem on skin. But that's our mask. So next stop is the full wash. All right, so that's our layer with pool. Next, I'm going to take some of this Baja Blue, sort of clear off my spray radius so I have less I have to clean, and start spritzing. And if you let it dry in between spritzes, it's less likely to oversaturate the paper, make the paper wet, make the this buckle, and it pool underneath. I am getting some pooling on that little seaweed right there, for example. So I'm going to let this dry and step away for a little bit. That first layer dried. Now it's time for another, just to sort of darken up, hopefully push the underwater effect. And I'm also going to spray some of the BG000. And that's a lighter blue-gray, so hopefully that'll push some of that back, so we get, you know, a good contrast of light and dark. And I'll let that dry so we don't get any seepage as well. So the nice thing about alcohol inks is they dry pretty quick. All right, and I think maybe one more with old Baja Blue. And old friend Indigo, which has given me some problems in the past. Oh yeah, for being too intense, gee. All right, so once again, gonna let this dry, then we'll revisit it. So I thought about it, and I realized that another way I could get that mottled underwater effect is if I take one of those alcohol prep pads and I dab it. And you can see it picks up a little bit of the... Not too much. It still remains almost the same color, but this is like applying spray rubbing alcohol. All right, so we need to remove this mask. You guys can definitely see the alcohol marker seepage I warned you about. Anywhere the spray alcohol sort of crept underneath our spray, our Frisket mask. And that's okay because our mermaid stayed pretty much untouched. So I'm going to clean this up. I'll get right back to you guys. Okay, so since we've finished masking everything off, finished spraying it down, it is time to get started in earnest. Now, I'm going to color her... Jeez. So I've got a couple decisions to make. I guess I'll start with the Spectra marker. This came in the ArtSnacks. This is one of the things we are actually testing today. And I am applying this right now over the blue. And I wanted it to look transparent, and I probably should have masked it off after I did the layer of pool, but before the sprays, because it's not really as standing out as much as I would have liked. This marker handles a lot like the Blick Studio brush markers, which are, you know, I really like those markers. And, you know, I haven't seen them in stores yet, but it's been a few weeks since I've been able to get out to an art supply store. And because this is an alcohol-based marker rather than a xylene marker, it will work with other alcohol markers, which also means that it will pick up smuts from other alcohol markers. Let's grab that little Denix sketchbook. It also means, though, that you can clean your nib fairly easily by scrubbing it on a paper surface. The color I received, salmon, is more of a sort of a fluorescent-y orange color than a true salmon. And the brush is a little bit shorter than the brush on a Copic. I have the feeling they pretty much use the same body as the Blick Studio brush marker. Maybe they've even worked out a deal with Blick. I'm not sure about that. That's just speculation. Next, I'm going to move on over to her skin. Actually, let me do her eyes first with BG000, and I need to wipe this marker down. And all I'm really doing is shading her eyes with some blue. And then while I'm at it, I'll add a bluish hue to her hair, since I'm really trying to push the fact that she's underwater. Now I'm switching back over to Copic for her skin, and I'm doing all of this on fluid watercolor paper. Right now, I'm just doing a pretty basic fill on her skin, just trying to get everything filled in before I start shading and adding details.
Thank you.
All right, so we're finally ready to move on to the water-based Fibralo. And I've got a water-based marker right here. So what I'm going to do to begin with is I think I'm going to apply my Fibralo to my nonstick craft mat and then use water to pick it up. And then I'll apply it directly to the paper when once I've built up enough of the colors I need. Now this is a brush-based or a brush-tipped water-based marker. And I'm going to try to use a water brush, and I may regret that. We'll find out. So one of the difficulties I'm already having is that once you've put it down, you can't blend it out. So I'm going to have to go switch to a real brush. I'll be right back. Okay, so I went and got myself a cup of clean water and a real brush. Let's try this again. The sort of nice thing, though, about this is since it doesn't seem to budge, I can actually use watercolor on top of this to apply an overall wash over our mermaid and get a more underwater sort of feel with this. And when I say wash, this time I mean in watercolor. But I'm going to finish my business with the Fibralo before I turn to watercolor washes to add sort of an undersea tone to the overall illustration. Camera is really butchering these colors. At least the little view screen makes it look like it is.
All right, I'm gonna let this first layer dry and then I'll work on darkening up the seaweed.
All right, so we're switching tactic just a little bit. I wanted to go ahead and apply that wash that's going to sort of tone the rest of this piece. And I'm actually going to use one of my Spectrum Aqua markers. And the color I'm currently using is Aquamarine, which is a very, very light blue. And you guys can see that the water doesn't affect the alcohol marker other than to add a tint over it. And that's because alcohol and water-soluble markers don't really intermix. They have different solvents. So you can use them together. I mean, not use them together as in, you know, create an illustration that relies on, you know, the two of them blending together. They won't blend together, but you can tone illustrations, like marker illustrations with watercolor, and not only will that expand your marker collection, but, you know, the effect is different. And these nonstick craft mats are great because you can use them for both as a like a temporary palette for both alcohol inks and for water-based inks. also just grabbed teal, another Spectrum Aqua marker. This is a much darker blue. And while my paper is still pretty saturated, I'm gonna go ahead and hopefully blend in some very underwater looking shadows. Ooga. And you guys may be thinking I strayed pretty far from my box, and that's true. But what I feel like the real inspiration behind this box is interplaying water-based media with alcohol-based media. And that was inspired with the Fibralo and the Ad Pro. So I've been mostly sticking to alcohol-based markers and water-based markers, sort of keeping that spirit of this box alive. Of course, that just might be my own personal bias because I really enjoy using alcohol-based inks with water-based inks. So maybe that's, you know, my own preferences rather than the intention of the box. But I hope this is still inspiring to some of you guys anyway. I also like how the sort of organicness of watercolor, not that the pigments are organic, but that the way it's applied is very hand of the artist, very can be very gestural. Like how that sort of, you know, breaks up the marker a bit and makes it, you know, look a little bit more less uniform and more like somebody applied something to the paper. All right, I'm going to let this dry and then I'm going to continue with the Fibralo. All right, so my paper has dried somewhat. It's time to apply another layer. And I don't want to apply it directly to the page because even though it does blend somewhat, it leaves some pretty harsh lines. I'm going to give this time to dry since I'm having some bleeding problems over here, and I'll pick it back up once the paper is no longer damp. Okay, so the paper is a little closer to being dry, and I'm going to try to work directly on the paper now, just to get this moving a little bit faster. Now, the Fibralo does have a fairly decent little brush nib. It's kind of comparable to the Sakura Pigma MB, the medium brush, in that it is not the biggest watercolor brush pin brush on the market. It's fairly small, in fact. It's bigger than the Dewcrafts watercolor brush pin brushes. And if you're interested in more information on that, please check out my blog. I did a post reviewing several watercolor brush pins, I guess about a year ago now. And I know several of you guys would find that interesting because I reviewed brush pins that weren't necessarily the most expensive ones, watercolor brush pins specifically. So I reviewed like Lyra and I reviewed Dewcrafts and I did used, what are they called? Crayola markers as watercolor pins. And so one of the things I'm noticing is I'm getting a lot of pushback when I, even if I'm trying to be careful, and I'm not super sure if that's just my marker, if that's the marker's fault, or if that's just my paper today is, you know, it's just it's very wet outside. It's been storming all afternoon. So, you know, it could really be just the weather outside. For those of you who are new to watercolor, the weather is going to dictate a lot of what you're able to accomplish. So just keep that in mind. Also means you need to be flexible and be willing to change your tactic. So I'm switching back over to the other technique I was using to apply color, which is applying it to my craft mat and brushing it on. And that way I'm not getting the harsh edges and I'm not getting like a weird sort of bleed through look, which doesn't really look like watercolor. It doesn't look organic enough. That said, with this method of applying color, it's very difficult for me to build up the shades I want. They're all too pale. That little brush just really doesn't put out enough ink or dye, really, for me to be able to make much progress. So it's all very slow, fine layers that, you know, may not even really be adding up to anything. So, you know, as of right now, I'm finding the Fibralo a little bit frustrating to use. But I might just not be using it properly. It did respond well, at least in my test, to the Tombow Blender. So I may have to save up my pennies and purchase a pack and do a larger review. And if you're interested in seeing that happen, if you are interested in that particular review, you can help make that happen by visiting my Patreon and throwing a few pennies my way. Art supply review is pretty time consuming. It's definitely gets expensive and there's just not a lot of prestige in it, especially for actual artists who do art supply review. So any sort of help you can give would be greatly appreciated. All right, so I think that's going to be my last layer of the Fibralo. I'm going to go right on back to the much juicier Spectrum Aquas. And since this is an undersea theme, the sort of variety of tones will really help sell the fact that this is, you know, under the waves. All right, so I'm gonna let this fully dry. I've got a few more tricks up my sleeve to show you guys, but that requires dry paper. So I will be back in a bit. All right, guys, so it is morning on a fresh new day, and my ArtSnacks challenge piece, or what started out as a challenge piece, has dried. So now I can progress to other techniques I wanted to try. And I Googled underwater because I wanted to practice drawing that sort of stripey effect that you get underwater. And I'm starting out with a Derwent Inktense watercolor pencil. And the reason I'm starting out with this is because I'm going to blend some of this out and do some layered effects with it and hopefully come up with something. So since the Derwent Inktense is not actually a watercolor pencil, it's an ink-type water-based pencil, once I wet this, it's going to become permanent when dry. So I can apply layers on top of it, and I don't have to worry about the previous layer getting unsettled or moving too much. So I need to allow my watercolor paper to dry before I can apply more color pencil or additional layers of my Derwent Inktense. So I'm going to do that, and I'll see you guys in a few minutes. All right, now that this first layer is dry, I can start refining it. And I'm still using the same Derwent Inktense pencil in antique white. And I'm going to eventually switch over to a color pencil, but I really wanted to sort of build up my sunlight reflections within the water beforehand. I wanted the option to have a softer look. One of the neat things about this is it'll go right over because it's not transparent. It's translucent to opaque. It'll go right over the inks, which sort of pushes, in my opinion, that underwater water reflect light reflection look. I was talking to my editor, my video editor, who's pointed out that there's probably a sort of way you can cheat or fake it or make it a lot easier for yourself than, you know, drawing all these reflections by hand. He pointed out that you probably could use some type of a solvent like water or alcohol, and it would reactivate the ink and you could pick that up with a paper towel. And that is a valid point. The problem is we're using mixed media right now. So, there wouldn't be uniform reactivation between the alcohol inks and the water-based products. So, you know, that might be something to try in the future. And I definitely think if you guys want to try it, you should definitely try it. I'm not trying to discourage you from experimenting. But on this sort of a thing, it's neat to learn how to do certain things, you know, kind of the old fashioned way, because it makes you, in the long run, it makes you really flexible. You're not relying on, like, you know, tricks to be able to get a certain effect. It's nice to know the tricks too, though, because sometimes they look better, and sometimes they're a lot easier to do than doing it by hand from reference. But, you know, I think it's important to know both. And in this situation, I can sort of pick where, what areas I'm going to work, and what areas are going to be more opaque than others. I brought it up because I thought that was an interesting point, something interesting to think about. So if you guys want to give it a try and maybe, like, reply to this video, that would be pretty cool. You would be helping other people, and you'd be helping me as well. So maybe we could all learn something today. Really get that community aspect going. It's been a goal for this channel for a while, and, you know, I'm still just kind of learning the ropes of YouTube while trying to keep everything else going, so I'm often not as progressive about that as I'd like to be. And speaking of community, I have a 2.5K milestone coming up. And if you'd like to be part of that, one of the ways you can help unlock that quicker is by subscribing to my channel, because I can only send out the prizes after I've hit 2.5K. I'm not sending them out before. The giveaway information is up. There is a video and a blog post explaining how to enter, and I'll link those right here. So what I'm giving away is a bunch of comic supplies. So if you like what I do and you're interested in doing it yourself, entering the giveaway might be a really good way to get yourself started. I'm giving away a first, a second, and a third prize package. All of them have some pretty good stuff in it. And one of the ways you can help, if you are a subscriber, is by sharing the giveaway video to your friends, encouraging them to subscribe to my channel, because there is lots of good stuff. And like I said, I can't give away the package until I hit 2.5K, which I'm not at yet. So, back on topic, I have finished placing the brighter white highlights where I wanted them. So I'm going to go ahead with water and dissolve them a bit. And what I really want is sort of a hazy blend effect, which is why I chose to use a watercolor pencil to build these up, is because I can blend it out. Well, really, it's an ink pencil, but it behaves like watercolor, except it's indelible. So once I have placed these things, I can't pick them back up. They're not going to smudge out. They're not going to blend out. Even if I add layers and layers of water to it, it's not going to go anywhere. But the reason I went with this is because I can selectively use water to sort of soften the lines, blend them out a little bit, pushing that underwater look. All right, so that layer is dried. It's now time to try out a new product. These are Glimmer Mists by Tattered Angels, and I got these at, I got two sets of them at Tuesday morning. It's a scrapbooking product, but this is like a pearl and white glimmer mist. Thought it would be fun to try out. And I don't know how it's gonna react, so I'm trying to be kind of judicious in where I spray it. All right. So it looks like there is a little bit of white pigment in there. Mostly opaque. I mean, mostly transparent though, because it's so watered down. And there's some pearl in there. So this is going to add a shimmer to the original that unfortunately you guys can't really see. But if one of you opts to purchase this piece, you'll be able to see that, no problem. And unlike alcohol inks, I'm actually trying to get it to drop some fat drops on here. Oh, well. Unlike alcohol inks, water-based inks and mists do take a little bit longer to dry. So you have to apply them in layers. So I'm gonna let this layer dry and I'll be back. All right, so my first layer is dried, and what you can primarily see is a lot of shimmer. It does reactivate some of the inks I'd laid down previously. So that's something you're gonna wanna keep in mind. I think these water-based spray inks are best done on top of like watercolor stuff, rather, I mean, marker stuff rather than the watercolor stuff. So another trick I'm gonna show you guys is you take some clean water. And you dip your brush into the well-mixed whatever you want to splatter, and then you can splatter larger drops rather than like the spray mist you're getting by hand. Now, the problem with these spray mists is they tend to settle very, very quickly because they have like large-ish pigments or particulates in there. So you do want to work quick or stop to shake your bottle. Of course, this will make a bit of a mess. And I've done this technique for you guys a couple times in the past. You can also paint with this stuff if you like. So we're gonna paint a few of the mermaid scales, or at least knock them in. And add some concentrated shimmer. This is not coming out as opaque. It's actually coming out as very transparent on her tail. And add some to her hair. So this really won't be a highlight so much as like a glitter accent that you only the person who physically holds the piece will be able to see. Add some of this also to the fish. And again, we need to let this dry before we can move on. And once again, that was Tattered Tattered Angels Shimmer Spray. You can make your own. I have found that when I use iridescent medium in a spray bottle or the pearlescent medium in a spray bottle, it tends to clog. So this isn't as likely to clog because the particles are finer. So it may be worth buying a bottle, especially if you see it at Tuesday morning on sale. So like I said, it is reacting a lot of the seaweed because those were semi-fugitive dye ink. So I'm going to see if I can dig up my FW pearlescent medium. Okay, so here is my FW pearlescent medium. You guys saw me use this in my May box, both the ArtSnacks and the Sketchbox challenges. So method is very similar. Dip it in water first, then dip it, and you're going to get a much whiter, much thicker, larger particle size by doing this. And this is one of those products that I have had a problem with, sort of clogging up the spray bottle, which is why I am doing it like this. This, however, doesn't really reactivate the water-based, at least in my experience before, the water-based water markers. Also, sort of tighten up those scales a bit. All right. All right, guys. So my ink has had plenty of time to dry. You can see where I splattered the pearlescent ink because it is a lot more, the pearlescent ink, because it's a lot more opaque. So we're moving on now to the color pencil, and we're going to use a Derwent Color Soft. They're one of my favorite white color or favorite color pencils, period. These are all opaque white tools from the opaque white kit I've put together. And that means I'm not scavenging or using up my white color pencils, because I will use these for a lot of non-color pencil tasks. So it means I always have a white color pencil still in my kit, and I also have a white color pencil for this sort of work. So finally, I wanted to start using, or I wanted to show you guys some of my favorite tools to mess around with. And these are gel pens by Sakura of America. And I've got some gorgeous colors here. I have, oh, I forgot to grab, a white glaze pen. Now this is a more transparent, pearly sort of white application than say using, you know, your white gel pen or your white gel jelly roll or your white Signo. This is going to be a little more subtle. I also have this amazing black ink that has a gold shimmer in it. And these are just, you know, jelly roll gold. And I also have a teal with that gold shimmer. And I thought these were like perfect mermaid colors. And I have a transparent sparkle. I have a gray tone sparkle and I have a black sparkle. Now, the glaze inside this white pearly glaze pen is very, very transparent. It's, you know, just barely there. So it's perfect if you really want to just add a little bit of subtle shimmer to something. So, you know, this pen is not really suitable for, you know, writing purposes. And I'm kind of hoping I can reactivate it, sort of blend it out a little bit with water. This is my first time getting to play with it in an art sort of capacity. So taking a synthetic brush, and it seems, let's see, I'm sure if I mess with it while it's still wet, that's one thing, but with these it's all about seeing if they'll blend out when they're dry. All right, I'm gonna let this dry and I'll check back in. Okay, so this is dried and you can see it's still very obvious. So I'm gonna try a cover-up job. I don't want it quite that obvious. So right now I'm using Mermaid, which was the same color as the initial layer of scales, and I'm just sort of going over all of it right now. seems to be covering fine. It's a little bit lighter, but I really don't mind that. Next, I'm going to take the Spectra AD and go over her fin. This might take a couple of layers. Probably goof the fin up to the point of not being able to salvage it anymore. We'll see. We'll find out. But yeah, the pearl glaze is not water soluble as much as I thought. It would not blend out. And it doesn't seem to be alcohol marker soluble. So at least there's that. At least I'm able to sort of noodle around with these corrections. Take some aquamarine and some water. Just trying to blend the hair back into something close to what it was. Sometimes my problem is I'll overwork things, which I think is the point we're getting to right now. And, it just never looks as good as it did before I decided to, quote unquote, improve things. I'm not really sure what I'm gonna do to salvage her fin. I'll have to figure something out. All right, we've hit the point of no fixing with these tail fins. So what I'm going to do is, when in doubt, black it out. It's a shame that I screwed them up to that point, but, when you're working in color, sometimes things go haywire, and the only option you really have open to you is just going over it in black and covering up your mistakes as much as possible. All All right, so I have a feeling I need to call this quits before it gets too much more out of hand. So this is my already very out of hand ArtSnacks challenge for June. The products that we used that were in the box were the Spectra Ad Pro, the Fibralo brush, and the layout pencil, which I seem to have, I don't know, misplaced somewhere. I used a bunch of other things, including alcohol ink sprays, Copic markers, Copic Wides, Spectrum Aquas, and Sakura jelly rolls. I hope you guys enjoyed this tutorial. I hope you found it interesting, useful. I hope I inspired you in some way. If I have, there's three ways you can help me. One, you can subscribe to my channel for even more art goodness. Two, you can share this video and any other video from my channel that struck your fancy to your social networks, because you'll help me build an audience. And that is super important to me right now, and I would really appreciate your help. Three, if you want to do something a little bit more, if you really, really believe in this sort of content, if it's really helped you, if it's saved you money in the past, if it's taught you a skill you wouldn't have otherwise had, please consider checking out my Patreon at patreon.com/natosoup for information on how you can help fund more art content like this. This content can sometimes be very expensive to write. I purchase many of these, if not most of these materials, out of my own pocket. And your financial support would really help me a lot, and it would really go far. I could produce even more content like this because I would have the time to dedicate to it. So that's something to think about. If you enjoyed this tutorial slash challenge and you'd like more, please remember to check out my blog for the full review comparing June ArtSnacks with June Sketchbox Basic, as well as my June Sketchbox Basic versus June Sketchbox Premium unboxing, overview, and challenge. So, if you check out the blog, there is also 7 years worth of tutorials, art school advice, portfolio prep, how to table at conventions, all sorts of goodies for you to check out. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you again later. Bye.